So actually, I'm going to discuss this book by Professor Anwar Moazzam. Professor Anwar Moazzam was the head of the Department of Islamic Studies at Usmania University. And this is a great labor of love. In Urdu, it's called Ghalib Ki Fikri Wabastagiyan. And he's edited it a bit in the English translation, but it's still a phenomenal work because it straddles Ghalib's intellectual concerns. That's the title, Nightingale of an Uncreated Garden. And it deals with the temper of the times, the religious movements, and then his intellectual sensibility, his aesthetic values, and all of that. It's, the title is taken from a very famous Urdu couplet by Ghalib. Ghalib says, hoon garmi ye nashate tasavvur se nagma sanj main andalibe gulshane na afrida hoon. I break into song out of the exuberance of my imagination. My flights of imagination take me so high that I break into song. My andalibe gulshane na afrida hoon. I am a nightingale of a garden, of a paradise which has not yet been created. Of the garden of paradise which has not yet been created. Now this kind of a thought is quite common to Ghalib. So I'll be discussing this. And Professor Amina Kishore has another book based on, she'll tell you.
I speak about a much simpler book. Simple in the sense that it's more reader-friendly and friendly to talk about, easy to talk about. It doesn't match, actually, the kind of profundity that is there in Professor Moazzam's book, but it's a friendly book for you and me and all of us here. This book, Mr. Razamir calls it Ghalib, A Thousand Desires. Again, a phrasal translation of one of his very, very famous couplets. We'll be talking about his kalam, and we'll be talking about Ghalib Shanasi, and we'll be talking about, to begin with, I would like to start on a note which I think will be accepted in a very empathetic manner by most of you. Most of us here sitting in this hall, as I see it, are outsiders to Ghalib. Most of us perhaps are outsiders to Urdu in the sense of not being really inside the language and the literature, perhaps. But I concede that there must be many of us who are very, very conversant with both these things. But having said that, I also want to add that this writer whom I hold in my hand, Razamir, his bio shouts out that he's a teacher of management. He's not a teacher of Urdu literature, nor a teacher of Ghalib. But he is a Ghalib lover, Ghalib Shinas, a student of Ghalib, once a student, always a student, that's how I see him. And the claim he makes right at the beginning is that he is writing this book specifically for an audience which he calls a new reader. A new reader into Urdu, a new reader into Ghalib, a new reader into Urdu poetry. He addresses them. And I think any book which has an addressee very clear in the mind designs itself on that purpose. And Mr. Razamir has successfully designed his book around this purpose of introducing Ghalib and introducing him as fully as he can. I don't know if you saw a little knot on my brow. When you try to introduce somebody fully, there are some problems there. I'll come to that very soon. But the design of the book, as I said, is reader-friendly in the sense that he neatly divides the book into two parts, each part again neatly divided into six parts, six sections. And what he does, as I think also Professor Anwar Moazzam has done, is to translate some of the couplets of Ghalib, some only, looking at the huge compendium of creative work from Ghalib, Some couplets from Ghalib have been selected by Professor Anwar Mohazzam, some by Raza Mir. Somewhere there may be an overlap, but both of them have done one thing very common. The similarity is where both of them have tried to translate, I'm using the word tried to translate the couplets, which I'm sure they've selected because they fit into the narrative that they are building around Ghalib. They've translated it into English. And that is the reason for the knot on my brow, because I have huge, big questions to ask and think and worry about regarding translation of poetry. There are so many temptations when you translate, and I think both the writers have very humbly, very modestly admitted to this, that there can be no completely perfect translation. There can be only an approximation. And I'm very happy to see that our writers are admitting to that. So on that happy note, I think we can start the ball rolling, Professor.
Yes, Professor Amana. Others have tried. Ralph Russell has tried, Ejaz Ahmed has tried, Pawan Verma has tried. Many people have attempted to translate Ghalib. But he is probably, arguably, the most difficult poet in the Urdu canon. And I am now, I have to start with a disclaimer. I am a student of, a very informal student of Urdu. So I make no claims to being Mahir Ghalibia, some expert on Ghalib or anything like that. Now we must remember that Ghalib's reputation rests largely on his ghazals. About his Diwan is what, some 235, 236 ghazals. Some are of course again discovered later, but his original Diwan, now that is what his reputation largely rests on. And we must remember that he completed, to a very large extent, his Urdu Diwan when he was barely 24, 25. And in fact, Malik Ram, the great Ghalib expert, says that the first manuscript of Ghalib, Ghalib himself had completed when he was 18 and sent for publication when he was 19, in 1816. So you can imagine. And then he turned largely to Persian. And many experts phase this out. They have four broad phases of his work. They say he first wrote in Urdu, and then 1821-22 onwards he turned to Persian. But he wrote off and on in Urdu. And then in the late 1840s, he turned to Urdu again when he started attending court mushairas and all of that. But Professor Anwar Mohazzam here is concerned more with Ghalib's intellectual themes. And he considers Ghalib, much like Eliot, to me when I was a student at college, I remember our professors introducing Eliot to us as a poet of poets. So Ghalib is a bit like that to me. He's all of the intellect. And that is how he looks at him. And of course, there are other elements in it, like the Sufi element, the Tasawwuf element, and his philosophy and so on. We'll come to that. That is how he divides his book into these chapters, these 5-6 chapters.
So I like the way Professor has summed up what Professor Mohazzam has done. But to say that Ghalib is a Sufi, Ghalib is a Sufi or a mystic or a philosopher, or I do not know whether I'll be doing justice to that. He can be a very mischievous poet. He can be extremely despondent. He can be jealous. He can be loved on. He can be, I don't know. You name an emotion in human nature, and Professor will find a ghazal share for that. That's how Ghalib is. But before I go into that further, let me also say something about us and Ghalib. Ghalib, I think, is in India at least, all over the South Asia now, I must say. He is so ubiquitous. He is so present. Just like I would quote Rabindra Sangeet, or I would quote Shakespeare, or I would talk of Kalidasa, I would also be speaking about Ghalib. Nadim is part of most Urdu speaking households' daily conversation. Ghalib is a part of any discussion of any topic, and then a line from Ghalib would sum up most of the things that we would want to say. Ghalib is ubiquitous in that way. So I do not think that I can even write a list of 20 words and say 20 terms and say here I am covering all the themes of Ghalib, or I am presenting Ghalib in his holistic frame. So, but a book which takes up one or two or three aspects of Ghalib is trying to address those aspects in a serious manner. And as I made a point earlier, Mr. Razami does not do that. He tries to present Ghalib in as much of a holistic manner as possible. Coming to that word again, holistic, I think is the second time I mentioned that word this morning. Ghalib's my analysis of, or Razamir's analysis of, or any excess analysis of Ghalib, generally, the books that Professor mentioned just now, we would like to talk about Ghalib as a whole, taking into consideration the Taine's philosophy, Taine's formula of res milieu moment, students of literature will understand. Where does he come from? What kind of a background he lived in? And what were the moments of epiphany that he confronted in life? Where does the poetry come from? So the man is supposed to be the source of all poems, and the poems are supposed to be the clue to the man. This is how we look at most poets. We do that. I do not know if I should be doing that, because I think that when I try to judge the man through his poems, perhaps my judgment is not complete or partisan. If I try to judge the poetry through the man, perhaps I'm omitting to look at the fact that poems can be born beyond the moment also, beyond the human presence also. For me, a poet can be a poser. For me, a poet can be adopting a persona. For me, a poet could tell himself, today I shall be the lovelorn man. The next moment, okay, I'm angry with something, therefore let me vent the pose of the angry man. I think a poet is capable of that. And I think that's what I personally like to look at from Ghalib. When I see a couplet from Ghalib, I find it rather hard to accept that this couplet was written for that day, for that moment, and therefore. If we say that, I think the couplet stops there. The share and its life stops there. The afterlife of the share comes to me only when I go beyond that moment, go beyond the possibility of that historic need to write that couplet, and then apply it elsewhere. If we had not been doing that, Ghalib would not have been applying himself to your lives and my lives. Ghalib's ashar in fragments or in full would not have been related by us to our lives. So this is my take on Ghalib, and Razamir by and large helps me in following what I feel is Ghalib. As I said, we are not talking about a book for scholars. We are talking of a book for general readership. And I strongly recommend this book for the general reader, because this will make you happy. And the collection of ashar that he has selected from Ghalib's anthologies, remarkable collection. He has done one thing that Professor Anwar Mozum has, he has not done one thing that Professor Anwar Mozum's book does. He offers, Professor Anwar Mozum's book offers the Urdu script along with the transcription, along with the transliteration and the translation. He does those three things. I think Ralph Russell also, to a great extent, does it. Razamir has not done that. I do not know the reason why he has not done it, but there are times when you would have wanted, especially people who are familiar with Urdu script, we would have wanted that the Urdu script also had been present alongside, because that is where the complete, no transliteration in my opinion can give you the complete the pronunciational aspects of a language. I think there are many songs in Urdu, I don't need to spell out, we'll be talking about that also by and by, but that is a problem which I have felt. There are certain
very sweet, very beautiful things in this book, and I would recommend you to look for a whole chapter where he analyzes the Ghazal of Ghalib. Instead of translating it into two-line couplet, into two-line share, into two-line couplet, instead of doing just that in a very arbitrary manner, he has devoted one whole chapter to the discussion of one Ghazal, and completely he discusses it through translation as well as a very prose paraphrase, which is a beautiful thing, and I think you'll fall in love with that Ghazal and with the style of Razamir when you read that. There's a second extremely interesting thing that I came across. He has termed this section of the book a prologue, and in the prologue he has divided it into four sections, and he creates a fictional episode, four episodes actually, of Ghalib in four phases of his life, and he admits they are fictional. He admits they are based on anecdotes and legends and commentaries and all. But that fictional presentation, I think, is quite poetic and quite, I think of it as the gems in that book, actually. That is sheer poetry, where you can delve into the life of a poet and not judge him by this or that, but through the poetry, through whatever you've heard of him, through hearsay, through documents, you have developed into a fictional narrative. And those very brief four fictional vignettes are extremely interesting to read. I thought, will your author do that? I do not know if he has dealt with anything like that.
No, Professor.
Because his completely different.
His focus is quite limited.
Yes.
You know, just as Professor Wahab Kaiser had focused on science in college,
oh, yes,
for example,
yes.
That's a very narrow field. I mean, to look for scientific ashar in Ghalib. So he did that part. And of course, he did a fairly good job as well. Now, the thing is that one thing we must remember is that Ghalib cut loose from tradition, both in poetry and in prose as in his letters. So the poetry of his times was very simple. You had his predecessors, Mir, Sauda, and Nasir, Atish, his own contemporaries, Momin, Zaw, Zafar, Azurda, Shefta. All of them wrote in a kind of Urdu which people of the period would understand. Whereas he adopted this extremely complex style from Bedil, the Persian poet who died in 1729, long before he was born. So, but he adopted that very difficult style, and if I were to give you examples, we would simply get blown away by the complexity of those images. It takes a while to put them all together and to string up the whole thing to make sense of them. And he himself then laments in many couplets, as in one particular share when he says, "Na janu nek hoon ya bad hoon, par sohbat mukhalif." I don't know whether I'm good or bad, but I know that the world around me is very different. "Na janu nek hoon ya bad hoon, par sohbat mukhalif hai. Jo gul hoon, toh gulqan mein. If I'm a rose, I'm in a furnace, in a bhatti. Jo gul hoon to hoon gulkhan mein, jo has hoon to hoon gulshan mein. If I'm a weed, then I'm in a garden. Either way, I don't fit here. I'm a misfit." That is what he said in one of his couplets. And his style is his most distinctive feature. Professor Anwar Mohsen talks about it. He has a chapter in this on Ghalib's expression. And that is something that many critics have spoken about. In fact, Dr. Akhtar Bijnori, Abdul Rahman Bijnori, says that Ghalib fashioned, he created a language of his own to suit his style and his expression. And that is what Professor Mohsen also talks about. He talks about Mani Afrini, to create meanings out of words. He gives certain examples. I mean, Abdul Rahman Bijnori gives certain examples. I remember offhand two of them, Sheher-e-Arzu. He says it had not appeared in Urdu before Ghalib. And then he says Dame-e-Shunitan had never appeared in Urdu poetry earlier. And so style is very, a very distinctive feature. That is one thing. The other thing is that Ghalib takes great pride in that. As we all know, कहते हैं कि गालिब का है अंदाज़े बयां. और he says that, and then he says, if you want to know how Urdu can rival Farsi or can be the envy of Farsi, he says, जो ये कहे कि रेख्ता क्यों ना हो रश्के फारसी गुफ्ताए गालिब एक बार पढ़ के उसे सुना के यूं. If somebody wants to know how Urdu can be the envy of Farsi, because Farsi was considered this, you know, by far superior language, गुफ्ताए गालिब एक बार, गालिब की शायरी एक बार पढ़ के उसे सुना के यूं, this is how, you know, then Urdu, you know, gets over Farsi in that sense. And then even when he is self-deprecating, when he is self-critical, when he knocks himself down, he says, हम कहाँ के दाना थे, किस हुनर में यकता थे, बेसबब हुआ गालिब, दुश्मन आसमां अपना. भाई फॉर डेस्टिनी टू, you know, to go after you, you have to be a genius. So he's saying, I'm this great man who was not recognized in his time. But he inverts it. Hum kahan ke dana the. And or when he says, ye laashe be kafan asade hasta chaangi hai. Haq maghfirat kare. Ajab azad mard tha. He says, this dead body without a kafan, without a cloth to cover it. Now even the poorest of the poor have a cloth to cover it. Huh? And he says, so he's lamenting upon his plight, takes self-pity. This is all about self-pity. But then he says in the end, ye laashe be kafan asade khasta jaan ki hai, haq maghfirat kare, may God forgive him, ajab azad mard tha. Again, he has to somehow, you know, score a point even there. Or when he says, hui muddat ke ghalib mar gaya par yaad aata hai, वो हर एक बात पर कहना कि यूं होता तो क्या होता. सो दैट्स क्वाइट सिंपल. एंड दिस इज समथिंग प्रोफेसर अनवर मोअज्जम आल्सो टॉक्स अबाउट, दैट ही इन हिज टाइम ही रेज्ड अ होल लॉट ऑफ इंटेलेक्चुअल क्वेश्चंस. देयर वर, इट वाज अ वेरी डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ अ दिल्ली फ्रॉम द दिल्ली दैट वी नो टुडे. क्वाइट ऑब्वियसली 19th सेंचुरी दिल्ली वाज अ कल्चरल हब. And several centers and schools of religious studies, great people. In fact, Maulana Azad once refers to Sadruddin Azurda's drawing room as an academy. He says his house, Azurda was a great poet, Ghalib's good friend. It was in, when, when a creditor came after Ghalib once and a decree was issued, Azurda was a judge. So Ghalib had to go in front of his friend Azurda. He felt very humiliated. And Azurda smiled and asked him, ye kya hai Mirza? And Ghalib is supposed to have recited, Muft ki peete the main, Phukat ki sharab peete the, credit pe, Muft ki peete the main, lekin samajhte the ke haan, rang laayegi hamari faqa masti ek. But I knew that someday this would happen, you see. And he mentions it in the sense that Professor Anwar Mohsen talks about all these associations, all these friends he had, who were attached to various schools. And Ghalib, on his part, he struck a path of harmony. That's what he points out. Sulh kul jo kaha hai unhone. So mera maslak hai sulh kul, he said.
Point that he raised about anecdotes around Ghalib. Anecdotes about Ghalib and Aam. Most of you know Ghalib ke khutoot are full of these witticisms and the way he approached his friends and his almost like Birbal, you know, almost in his wit and his intelligence and his repartee. So you have many examples. But as I have said, anecdotes cannot be the substance of research. That's why Professor Mohsen's book stands
way shoulders above any kind of scholarly work, because he not only talks about Ghalib's Urdu Kalam, but he has an in-depth knowledge, and he makes great forays into his Farsi Kalam also. So it's a very imposing kind of a book. The most Urdu departments in universities try to separate the two Ghalibs, the Farsi Ghalib and the Urdu Ghalib. I wonder why there have been no reaching outs from one to the other. Maybe because the Kalam did not appear to be very different from one the other, I do not know. But as I said, as I was saying, that I'll leave it to you to answer, Professor. But as I was saying, that without the Farsi Kalam, I do not know. I consider myself only a very peripheral student and an admirer of Ghalib, mainly because of this. Because I have not stepped into a whole world that he has created through his Farsi Kalam. So I would like you to tell us a little bit more about that.
Professor, my understanding of Farsi is very limited and definitely not enough to comprehend Ghalib. And Ghalib himself was very proud of his Farsi work, because he says, if you want to really study me, then look at my Farsi work. Professor Anwar Muazzam refers to that in his work. He says, Farsi bhi tababini naqsh hai rang rang. If you want to see the richness of my varied experience, look at my Farsi work. But guzar majmua urdu ra, pass away, put my Urdu work aside. Ke berange manas, he says it is berang, absolutely bland. It has nothing in it of the richness that my Farsi kalam has. Ideally, all universities in their Urdu departments should have a course on Farsi, so that students of Urdu are initiated into Farsi, because all the masters wrote in Farsi. That is why, I mean, Professor Anwar Muazzam knows good Farsi. Arabic, of course, he knows very well. So he knows the whole background in which Ghalib would have lived and spent his life. But teachers today know zero Farsi. So how can you interpret somebody like Ghalib or many of the others without a proper understanding of Farsi? That's my thing. And when he says he is a poet of the intellect, I am reminded of what the humorous poet from Pakistan, Dilawar Figar, said. He says, "Pahunch gaya hai wo us manzile tafakkur par," of imagination, thought. "Pahunch gaya hai wo us manzile tafakkur par." Jahan dimaag bhi dil ki tarah thadakta hai. It's such a beautiful tribute that he pays. And even someone like Iqbal not only did not praise many poets, but he has a nazm on Ghalib, in which he says, he compares Ghalib to Goethe, by the way, in that nazm. You must read it. I'm sure it would be there on the internet somewhere with transliteration and all that. I'm sure you'd be able to find it. And he says, there's one sheer that I remember. He says, "Lutfe goyai mein teri hamsari mumkin nahi." He says, when it comes to expression and the joy of expression, the exuberance of expression, nobody can match you. You're peerless, he tells Ghalib. See, "Lutfe goyai mein teri hamsari mumkin nahi. Ho taqayyul kaan jab tak fikre kamil hum nashi." Till such time as there is somebody who is as perfect as you in imagination, nobody can match you, he says. So that is something about Ghalib that we must know. And talking about the spontaneity of things, normally you are right that when people write for an occasion, it doesn't have that literary value. Many of Ghalib's Qasidas, poor fellow wrote so many Qasidas, praising so many Nawabs and kings and British residents and viceroys and the queen and everybody.
Change the address.
Yes, exactly. Sometimes instead of Nawab of Rampur, it would be Nawab of Farukhabad. You see, the same Qasida with a few changes here and there. But you see, the Qasidas are not remembered. We remember him for his ghazals. That's the thing. But there's one very interesting anecdote, talking of anecdotes, which Ali recalls. in Yadgar-e-Ghalib that there were a few highly erudite people sitting in Calcutta when Ghalib went there, and they said in his time, Akbar's time, Faizi could write 5,000 couplets at one go on any topic. 5,000 ashar he could write. So Ghalib said, aaj bhi aise Allah ke bande hain jo 5,000 nahi to 50 to keh lenge. So he put a betel nut on his palm. Maulvi Kareem Hussain, I think was his name. He put a betel nut on his palm and he said, okay, go on, let's see what you have to say. And then Ghalib takes off from there. Hai jo sahab ke kafe dast pe ye chikni dali zeb deta hai ise jis qadar acha kahiye. And he goes on, hum angusht badanda ke ise kya likhiye. I mean, it's in very highly personalized Urdu, so to break it down word by word would be a challenge. But sometimes there is this spontaneity in Ghalib, as we also know about har ek baat pe kehte ho tum ke tu kya hai. It is supposed to have been written on the spot, see, because he was apparently carrying this blank sheet with him, and when Badshah asked him to recite, he recited this beautiful ghazal. It is such a long ghazal, as you know.
That's exactly what I was saying before we wind up. I have just one or two points to make. See, a scholar would look into the anecdotal references, the sources, and you know, you are able to bring it out. But for you and me, har ek baat pe kehte ho tum ke tu kya hai, stands on its own feet. I do not need to know where it began and where it all comes from. That's what I'm trying to say, that enjoy Ghalib as much as you can on your own. And that's what poetry is. It allows you to knock on its door and enter. But you have to enter with a clean heart, a tabula rasa, and see, be ready to be affected by that poet. And I think that opens itself to you any time. That's how I see it.
इत्तेफाक से उर्दू भी जवाब सवाल दोनों हो सकते हैं, और हम लोगों ने ये डिसाइड किया था कि शायद यहाँ अंग्रेज़ी ज़्यादा सलीस लगे, मगर सलीस उर्दू हर जगह चल सकती है. उर्दू, हिंदी, हिंदुस्तानी, इट्स ऑल बिल्कुल चल सकती है साहब.
एक और जगह कहते हैं गालिब, वेयर ही टेक्स अ डिग एट बहादुर शाह जफर ऑल्सो, के मैं और रेख्ता वो मैं रेख्ता का शायर ही नहीं हाँ, मैं और रेख्ता इससे मुद्दा जुज इन बसाते हजरत खातिर हजरत नहीं मुझे, है ना. ही सेड अपार्ट फ्रॉम प्लीजिंग द बादशाह आई नेवर रोट इन उर्दू, आई एम नॉट एन उर्दू पोएट. हाँ, कोई सवाल हो तो जरूर कीजिए.
रश्के फारसी कैसे हो तो मेरी गुफ्ते गालिब एक बार पढ़कर उसे सुना कि यूं यूं होता है. ये तो अदा है. कभी एक दिन मैं कहती हूँ कि मुझे फारसी अच्छी लगती है, कभी मुझे दोनों ही अच्छे लगते हैं गालिब को मेरे ख्याल से.
यू आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट, एंड वी आर आंसरिंग आवर ओन क्वेश्चंस, बिकॉज इन वन ऑफ हिज लेटर्स व्हिच ही राइट्स टू आई फॉरगेट हु, आई थिंक इट इज हातिम अली मेहर, ही सेज look at this ghazal of mine, and it's an Urdu ghazal. He says, look at this beautiful ghazal of mine, huh? And recognize it for what it is worth. So, haan, boli. Sorry.
Nahi, aap.
Nahi. Haan, jay, jay. Jo bahut aam nahi hai. Nahi, pareshani ye hai, wo to suna sakte hai. Magar ye hai ke kahan tak samjhenge, उससे हम वो अच्छा वो करेंगे. उससे पहले एक करूंगा मैं कि देर आर थ्री वेज, जस्ट गिव मी वन मिनट, ओके, टू वाइंड अप. सॉरी, देर आर थ्री वेज टू एक्सेस गालिब. वन हिज पोएट्री विच इज मोर कॉम्प्लेक्स इन उर्दू, वन हिज पर्शियन पोएट्री विच वी हैव नो एक्सेस टू, एंड ऑफ कोर्स हिज लेटर्स. His letters are a treasure written in very simple Urdu. Again, very different from the style of the times. People used to write in very difficult prose. Ghalib adopts a very very simple conversational tone, and I will read out two lines from, because I've brought Ghalib ke khutoot. Huh? So I will read out some two lines from three letters. That's all. Yeah. See, this is Mir Mehdi Majrooh ke naam. He was a student of Ghalib's and also his contemporary. He says, "Wah wah, Sayyid Sahab, tum to badi ibarat araiyan karne lage, nasr mein khud numaiyan karne lage." He says, "Arey, acha likhne lage bhai tum." Huh? And then he says, "Bhai, tum to Urdu ke Mirza Khatil ban gaye ho." Huh? Mirza Khatil was a poet of Farsi, also a great scholar, researcher, or Ghalib's contemporary. And then he says, Mir Mehdi, subah ka waqt hai, jaada khoob pad raha hai, angethi samne rakhi hui hai, do harf likhta hoon, aag taapta hoon, aag mein garmi sahi, magar haan, wo aatish-e-sayyal kahan. Aatish-e-sayyal is literally fire water. Sharab, magar wo aatish-e-sayyal kahan? He says, and then in another letter he says, I'll read just this one line. He says, ha ha ha, mera pyara Mehdi aya, aao bhai, mizaj to acha hai, baitho. Now this is in a letter. Haan, Mir Mehdi Majrooh is somewhere else, and this is what Ghalib claims in another letter. He says, I have invented a style of letter writing. कि मैंने वो एक तर्ज ईजाद की है कहते हैं.